Good morning, everyone, and welcome once again to the Des Moines Church of Christ. For the past several weeks, we've been studying Paul's letter to the Philippians, and it's been really encouraging to hear comments from many of you from all over the states and even abroad as well. And people have been sharing just about how this series or how individual lessons in the series have been helping them personally. I got a note from Taylor here in Des Moines who said, "This is good stuff. It brings to the surface great self-reflection." Good comment. Mary Grace from General Santos, Philippines says, "Thank you, Brother John. I learned a lot about knowing Jesus Christ more." Cool. And then Lori from Maryland wrote, "Great, very timely message in today's world and really always." Got a few video comments as well.
I am so super excited about the series that we have on Philippians because it really helps me to understand the fullness in Christ, the power, the grace, and the truth that we have in Christ.
Amen.
So I like the Philippians series, not just because John Lusk is a great preacher, and not just because we get to see the character of Paul, but because we're reminded that we should live our lives in a manner that is worthy of the gospel.
Amen to that. I hope the series has been helpful to you so far as well. So far, we've covered the important historical background information about this letter so we can understand it more fully. Then we also covered chapters 1, 2, and 3. If you missed any of those lessons, please watch them here on our YouTube channel. And I'm going to show you what the homepage of the YouTube channel looks like so you can know what you're looking for. You can see any of the Philippians lessons right there and click on them, or you can go up to videos. And if you click on videos, you can see all the sermons, all the sermon series that we've uploaded here since COVID began. And there's some really good series to consult or to share with your friends. Or you can click on playlists, and playlists will separate all the Sunday sermons from all the midweek lessons, all the devotionals, and so forth. And there you can find my wife speaking to all the women in some of these midweek devotionals as well. So I hope you check out our YouTube page and subscribe and even hit the notification bell. So every time there's something new, you're going to get a message sent saying there's something new from the Des Moines Church of Christ YouTube page. So thank you for watching that with us. Now we're going to dive into the final chapter of this letter. And it really is the crescendo of the message. where Paul drives home all that he's been building towards so far. Again, there's just so much great stuff in this chapter. We're going to have to cover it in two parts again. The first part today, we're only going to cover four verses, believe it or not. But there's so much jammed into those four verses. And then next week, hopefully, we'll be able to wrap it up. So let's start off by diving into chapter 1, verse 1 through 4. Therefore, my brothers and sisters, you whom I love and long for, my joy and crown, stand firm in the Lord in this way, dear friends. I plead with Euodia, and I plead with Syntyche to agree in the Lord. Yes, I ask you, my true companion, help these women, since they have contended at my side in the cause of the gospel, along with Clement and the rest of my co-workers, whose names are in the book of life. Rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again, rejoice. Okay, what a cool section of scripture this is. You notice how I've called this section here in the heading, In the Lord. In the Lord, in these four verses, Paul talks about three different ways that we are to live in the Lord. And so that's going to kind of serve as the outline and the focal point of the lesson here today. Let's zoom in to each of these verses and dig deep into each verse and see how it applies to our life. First, in the beginning, verse 1. Therefore, my brothers and sisters, you whom I love and long for, my joy and crown, stand firm in the Lord in this way, dear friends. So the first appeal about in the Lord is to stand firm in the Lord. He actually starts this new chapter out with therefore. Now, whenever there's a therefore, you got to look and see what the therefore is there for, okay? Here, it's tying back in what he's just written about how we're eagerly awaiting a Savior to bring us all to heaven. Remember how Paul said he was looking ahead to the prize for which God had called him heavenward in Christ Jesus? And we studied out a few other places in his letters where he talked about that prize, or he talked about that crown. And we saw that the prize wasn't just his own salvation, though that's an awesome prize, but it's also the salvation of others, that they too are part of his prize, and they too are part of his crown. And that's what he says, even right here in Philippians. He says that again. He says, you Philippians, you're my joy. You're my crown. You're the crown for which God has called me heavenward in Christ Jesus. That's pretty cool. And then he gives this appeal to stand firm in the Lord. That phrase just conjures up in my mind an image of a true man or woman of God standing strong when the winds and storms and waves of life are blowing and tossing and crashing all around him. There's just this man or woman of God standing firm in the midst of this. And man, that's exactly what all of us want to be doing during this crazy 2020 time where there's storms assailing us from every direction. The only way we can truly stand firm is to stand firm in the Lord. It has to be in the Lord. And what does that mean, in the Lord? Well, in a relationship with Christ, focusing our hearts and our minds firmly on Jesus, and as he just referenced, on the goal of heaven. That's how we stand firm, focused on Jesus, focused on heaven. We're not distracted, we're not drowned, we're not overcome by all those storms all around us. So stand firm in the Lord. He's already used this phrase, in the Lord, prior to this time. He's used it several other times in Philippians. He talked about being confident in the Lord. He talked about hoping in the Lord. He talked about calling the Philippians to welcome servant leaders to their fellowship in the Lord. And he's going to use that phrase two more times in this short section as well. So after talking about standing firm in the Lord, he dives right into one of the main reasons for which he wrote this letter, to address the disunity there in the church. We knew there was some disunity, and he's talked about it in general ways, that we're to be like-minded and having the same love, and he calls us to be unified. But now he gets really down to the nitty-gritty and what was causing the division in the church. And so we'll look at this, verse 2 through 3, and I'm calling this section, Agree in the Lord. He says, I plead with Euodia, and I plead with Syntyche to agree in the Lord. Yes, and I ask you, my true companion, help these women, since they have contended at my side in the cause of the gospel, along with Clement and the rest of my co-workers, whose names are in the book of life. He gets really personal, and he addresses two specific women by name, Euodia and Syntyche. Now, we don't know that much about these two women, but just from this passage, we can tell a number of cool things. First of all, we know that they're co-workers with Paul. He says that in verse 3. And thus, they're pretty prominent women in the church. Remember, Paul just did not take anyone on his missionary journeys, and he didn't consider just anyone a co-worker. But he specifically says, listen, these two women were my co-workers in the gospel. And just on that note, it's another verse where we can see how Paul really does elevate the role and the prominence, the significance of women in the church. I really do appreciate that. And I know the women appreciate that. And then he goes on to say that these women have had some kind of a disagreement about something. Now, we don't know what the disagreement was. No one has any idea. There's no clues about what it was. But we know that this disagreement had grown and spread. It's become known to the whole church. And thus, it's apparently causing division within the whole church, which is why Paul's addressing it in front of the whole church. And it's important to note, like I said earlier, he addresses them personally by name, publicly. You know, Paul was gentle and respectful in his relationships with other people, but he was also really direct when he needed to be. Think about it this way. How would you feel if I were delivering a sermon just like this one, and then I addressed two of you women, by name and appealed to you to be unified in front of everybody else who's watching this sermon? What if I just said, Kim and Karen? Okay. They're not disunified. They're actually really good friends. But Kim and Karen, listen, you girls, you need to work out your problems and get unified. And hey, you know, I know you're not asking it, but Todd and Adrian, could you get in there to help them out? Even though they're not asking for help, they may not welcome that help, but can you get in there because they really need that help? Man, that was bold just to do it in front of everyone like that. And you know, Jesus did the same thing in his spoken messages over and over. He didn't talk just in general terms. He got really specific and even confronted and challenged and called out individuals by name and by position to the crowds that he was speaking to. So this is actually kind of the biblical approach, if you will, in how to address these things. Well, this appeal to get resolved in our personal conflicts, it's a good thing for us to see. Because if we're honest, all of us have relational struggles at times, right? I know a lot of my job is helping resolve those conflicts in others' lives, within the local congregation here, as well as with relationships literally all over the world. But you know, I've also had those same challenges in my own life over the years, from my marriage, to my relationship with my daughters, to other church leaders, to my best friends. And what relationships don't have conflicts at times, right? Every meaningful relationship is bound to have conflicts. That's a given. But how you deal with those conflicts makes all the difference, not only in your life, but in the lives of the people around you as well. And even conflicts between just two Christians, two fellow Christians, really are big deals in God's eyes. He wants them resolved. He wants unity. This whole letter is largely written just to help resolve this one conflict between these two individuals. God desires unity that much. Well, it's interesting to see other ways that Paul addressed this in his letters. In Ephesians, he references the importance of this unity and this resolution in another way. In Ephesians 4, verse 26, he says, "In your anger, do not sin. Do not let the sun go down while you're still angry. And do not give the devil a foothold." Ooh, that's a good one. You know, Satan is always trying to get a foothold, right? He's always just trying to get a place. In Greek, that literally just means a place. He's just trying to get a small place. He's trying to get a little in. And then what he does is over time, 2 Corinthians 10:4 talks about, he turns those footholds into strongholds. He turns those little places into fortified places. They grow, they expand, and he gets a big foothold and he starts to divide people through it. Satan loves division. It's what he does. It's what he lives for. It's one of his number one purposes and one of his number one weapons. It's what he did from the very beginning in the Garden of Eden. His plan in all of our relationships is to get a small foothold and then over time turn it into a stronghold and then divide us and divide other people through it. It may start with a little disagreement or a personal hurt that just doesn't get resolved. And then it gets fueled by further assumption, tension, and then distance between the people, and then gossip. And then it spreads to others and deepens to become division. Division in friendships, division in families, division in ministries, division in churches. I've seen this over and over. All of those families, friendships, ministries, churches just get splintered by these small disagreements, these little places, these footholds that Satan turned into strongholds. And if you think about it on a much larger scale, the same things happen to our whole community, right? To our state, to our nation, with race, politics, and so much more. It just splinters everything into division. The Hebrew writer warns about this same thing in yet a different way. Hebrews 12 in verse 14. He says, make every effort to live in peace with everyone. See to it that no one falls short of the grace of God, and that no bitter root grows up to cause trouble and defile many. Ooh, that's an insightful passage. I have an illustration of that. The other day, I was mowing the yard, and I noticed I had a bunch of huge weeds in my front yard, and they were some sort of like this purple crabgrass that was like really big and really strong. And when I went to pull out the crabgrass, I could see that it had all started as one little root. But then over time, it had grown, it expanded, it got other stalks, and it got huge. I mean, some of these patches were like almost a foot across of this crabgrass. And as I was pulling it up, I saw that the crabgrass was actually covering over the regular grass, taking all the nutrients out of the regular grass and keeping it from getting sunlight. And the regular grass under it, the nice grass, was all withered and dead. And just that weed was there spreading and spreading. Well, that's exactly what can happen in any family, in any friendship, in any community, in any church, with bitterness and resentment. All it takes is a little bitterness within one person's heart, and it grows. It causes trouble, and it defiles many. That's what the Hebrew writer is talking about. So what's Paul's solution back in Philippians? What does he say is the solution to this disagreement, this disunity that was rooted in the relationship of Euodia and Syntyche? Well, he gives them this appeal, agree in the Lord. Literally in Greek, it says, be of the same mind. Think alike. Agree. Be of the same mind. Well, that sounds good, but how do you do that? Again, it's important what he says after that. It's in the Lord. Agree in the Lord. There's that phrase again. And that means a few things here. That can mean a few specific things right here in this context. First, he's saying, don't react like you would in the world. It's not agree in the world. Don't react like you would in the world with pride, self-righteousness, conflict avoidance, slander, gossip, bitterness. Those are worldly ways to deal with hurt and conflict. But you know, much of our lives, if we're honest, we've been experiencing the training of the world to respond to conflicts and hurt in those exact ways. And so what's reflexive and natural to us is to just try to kind of deal with it in the world. That's why Paul says, no, agree in the Lord. There's a better way. You have to consciously, deliberately stop and remind ourselves not to do it in the world, but to do it in the Lord. Also, agree in the Lord can mean that while you may not agree on all the individual issues and perspectives, you can still agree in the Lord. This is really important. See, we're so diverse in so many ways, like we've been talking about all throughout Philippians. We're all so diverse in so many ways. We think differently. We feel differently. We have totally different perspectives on life. And so, of course, we're going to have different perspectives on individual situations and different hurts and different feelings. To agree on every issue, it's impossible. But to agree in the Lord is absolutely possible. To agree on every issue is impossible, but to agree in the Lord is absolutely possible. And it also means that the Lord is at stake. When he says agree in the Lord, he's bringing the Lord into it. The Lord's at stake. If you're divided from your brother or sister in the Lord, then the church, the body of Christ, Christ himself, the Lord himself, is being divided. And that's why even just two people, a small conflict, is really serious business, because it divides the Lord. So to agree in the Lord, it means to focus on the Lord, to focus on his priorities, his will, his grace, to see the common ground you have in the Lord, and realize that that's ultimately all that matters. That's what matters the most. Our citizenship, ultimately, it's in heaven, right? Like we talked about last week. So he's saying, major in the majors, minor in the minors. Stuff in the world, that's minor. Stuff in the Lord, that's major. Now, our individual issues may not feel minor, but compared to the unity in Christ, they're absolutely minor. Then back in verse 2 through 3, he goes a step further to appeal to Yodia and Syntyche to get help from their brothers and sisters in the Lord. And it's kind of cool he says this. He says, I ask you, my true companion, to help these women. Now, we have no idea who that true companion is. It can be translated loyal yoke fellow. Okay, that's like an older translation. My true companion. Some people say it was a disciple named Syzygus. Some people say it was Luke, because Luke knew him so well. Some people say Timothy, his true son in the faith, or Epaphroditus, because he knows him so well. He's carrying the letter back to the Philippians. Or it could be Silas, one of Paul's primary partners in the gospel. Some people even say that Paul had a wife and it was Paul's wife. Okay, that's reaching, okay, because I don't think he had a wife. But there's someone there that knows what he's talking about when he says, hey man, I need your help to get in here and help these women out. It's somebody that they all respected and somebody that Paul trusted to be able to help out. You know, I've been this over the years for other people when they've been stuck. I've been that loyal yoke fellow, okay, that trusted companion to get in there and help bring about resolution. Likewise, I've been in the conflict, sometimes with my wife, or very close friends, or with another leader in the church, and I need somebody, a true companion, to both of us to get involved and just help us to bring about unity. It really does work. It's not a penalty to get help like that. It's a benefit. It's a blessing to get help like that. So if you're in a big disagreement in a relationship in the church, one thing you cannot do is let it remain that way. You cannot let it remain that way. And you cannot try to do it on your own. You got to get help. That's what the Bible is exemplifying right here and showing right here. It's not an option in God's church, in Jesus' church, for Jesus' people to be in this kind of a conflict with one another. There's just too much on the line. Yeah, it's uncomfortable to deal with these issues. I'm sure it was uncomfortable for Yodia and Syntyche to have the disagreement in the first place. It was uncomfortable for the whole ministry to see this division. It was uncomfortable for Paul to write a letter from prison about this issue. It was uncomfortable for Yodia and Syntyche to be called out publicly, not only in front of the whole church and all the Christians there reading the letter, but actually they were called out in front of all of us. Every person that reads the Bible for all generations, thousands and thousands of years, I mean millions and millions of people, we all know about the conflict of Yodia and Syntyche, okay? This is all pretty uncomfortable stuff. We can ask them about it in heaven, right? But it's uncomfortable. It's not easy, but it's worth it. It's worth it. Right now, are you in some sort of a conflict like that? Do you have an unresolved problem or hurt? Or do you know someone who is in a conflict like that? This is the clear biblical direction on how all of us should handle it, from the people in the conflict as well as the people who are witnessing it, to get involved and help them out, whether they're asking for the help or not. Unity is just so precious in God's sight. It's worth the discomfort. And you know, when you get unified again, it's such a weight lifted. Okay, you remember that song? This really dates me. This was even, I think, before my generation, but I heard it on the radio growing up. Reunited and it feels so good. You remember that? Reunited and it feels so good. Okay, any of you remember who that was? I had to look it up. Peaches and Herb. What a name for a band. Peaches and Herb. Okay, but it's true. Reunited and it feels so good. Resolving conflict is worth it because it feels so good. Well, it's pretty cool that right after he talks about all this relational conflict and resolution, pretty heavy topics, he goes on to talk about joy in the Lord, from a heavy topic to a happy topic. And this next sentence that we're going to look at, the final one here in this sermon today, is that rejoice in the Lord. And it simply says, rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again, rejoice. You know, Paul's been a great example of rejoicing like this, of having joy in spite of his circumstances. And he writes about joy and rejoicing a lot in this letter while being in prison, okay? A lot of bad things were going down in his life, but he's just such a great model of how you can be joyful in the Lord even when nothing else is going good around you. And so in this short letter, he uses the word rejoice or joy 13 different times in these four short chapters. Look at the way he's used it. I've saved these. I've not mentioned these or focused on these so far because I wanted to wait till we got to Philippians 4, which is really the crescendo in the appeal to be joyful. But look at what he said so far about joy and rejoicing. Chapter 1, verse 4. In all my prayers for you, I always pray with joy. 1:18 through 19. All that matters is Christ is preached. And because of this, I rejoice. Yes, and I will continue to rejoice, for what has happened to me will turn out for my deliverance. 1:25, I will continue with you for your progress and joy in the faith. Chapter 2, verse 2, he says, make my joy complete by being like-minded. He says, get along, it'll make me joyful. Chapter 2, verse 17 through 18, even if I'm being poured out like a drink offering, I'm glad and rejoice with all of you. So too, you should be glad and rejoice with me. Chapter 2, verse 29, talking about Epaphroditus, welcome him in the Lord with great joy. 3:1, my brothers and sisters, rejoice in the Lord. 4:1, my brothers and sisters, you whom I love and long for, my joy and my crown. And then in 4:10, he says, I rejoiced greatly in the Lord that at last you renewed your concern for me. It's so cool that he's done this and references so many times. And so now he gives this command one more time, actually two more times, in chapter 4, verse 4, rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again, rejoice. It's pretty interesting that he brings to a head all this example and all this reference to joy and rejoicing by commanding the Philippian Christians to rejoice. It's a straight-up command. Do you notice how in the NIV, some of your translations, it has an exclamation mark after it? That's because in the tense, the word that's used in Greek, it's strong. It's not saying, hey, you might want to try to be a little more joyful. He's just saying as a command, rejoice. He does it in 3:1, and then he does it twice in 4:4. You know, there's not many direct commands in all of Philippians. There's a lot of sharing, a lot of heartsy stuff, but not a lot of direct commands. But this one is repeated 3 times just in 2 chapters. Paul was absolutely serious about it. And when he gives this command, rejoice, with that exclamation mark, it's an absolute command without qualification, without parameters. It's an unconditional appeal. Rejoice in the Lord, period. No matter what's going on around you. He's just saying, be joyful. That's an expectation of God. Okay, that reminds me of this story. Growing up, my dad went through this phase where he was like into photography. He was like me, you know, he had a hobby and he would go all after it, you know, for a while, then move on to a different hobby. But at one point, he was really into photography. And he loved the idea of taking a family picture and sending it out on Christmas cards. That's before it was really even popular. It was a long time ago. And so one year he had the idea that we were going to do it while we're on a family vacation in, I don't know, I think it was in Nag's Head or something like that, North Carolina. It was on a beach. And so we're all out there, 6 kids, 2 parents. And he has all 6 kids go stand in the water. And we're standing in the water while he's getting the camera all set up and stuff like that. And he wanted to get the sunset just right. And then what we do is when he'd say go, we'd all hold hands and we'd come running, splashing into the water. And he would take the picture. Only my dad like had very high expectations. So we had to do it again and again. And again, we can even feel like little crabs nipping at our toes and stuff like that. Like, are we done yet, Dad? Well, my brother was like 13 years old. He was in those years where just kind of grumbling about a lot of things, okay, and not really up on Dad's authority. And so he was extra complaining. He just had a bad attitude and he's like making this frown. Well, then my dad just called him out on it. Kind of like Paul called these people out. He just called him out. He said, Mark, smile, darn it. Okay, only he didn't say darn it, okay? And all of us were just like, oh. And Mark was just like taken aback by that. Well, the very next shot, we're running in and Mark has kind of got this, kind of like I'm doing the bare minimum. So my dad stopped smiling, kind of this half fake smile. And that became our Christmas card. So every year we can look back on this Christmas card. And honestly, every time I see it, I just think of that command, smile. Darn it. Okay, that's not what God is saying to us. He's not saying fake like you're happy. Christians are supposed to pretend they're joyful always. Christians are supposed to put on a smile and fake it. He's not wanting us to fake it, but he's wanting us to be it. God is not wanting us to act joyful, but to be joyful. And we can be. He wouldn't command it if it weren't something we could attain. Because it's being commanded, it really can be attained without exception, irregardless of circumstances. Once again, the key to rejoicing and being able to really rejoice always, like he says, is to rejoice in the Lord. Again, it's totally different from rejoicing in the world. It's not a joy based on what you see or the physical circumstances of life, but it's on what you don't see and on the spiritual realities of life. He's not saying it's bad to rejoice in the world. That can be great. There's a lot of joyful things in the world, but he's not commanding that. He's commanding us to rejoice in the Lord, and that's the only way you can truly rejoice always. The more focused on the Lord you are, the more you can rejoice in the Lord, no matter what's happening in your life or around you. See, focusing on His love, His lordship, His will, His wisdom, His values, His visions, His compassion, His cross, His resurrection, His rejoicing, His home, our heaven. That's the source of joy that never fades. That's what we can all truly rejoice in always. This crazy year of 2020, it's the perfect time to apply this. See, it's not so easy to find joy in the world. A lot of the things that brought us joy before COVID, like our relationships, our hobbies, our lifestyles, going out to eat in different places, going out with friends, I mean, all those things have been modified or taken away completely, and they used to give us joy. And so now we're like, man, I don't feel joyful. And it's without that joy that we used to have, that joy in the world, man, a lot of people are feeling depressed. I know I've struggled with that, that you just feel depressed. You're not getting that joy infused in you. And so most of the country is struggling with some degree or another with depression like that. Again, I know I've felt it. But if your joy is truly in the Lord, He hasn't changed during COVID one bit. He's just as loving, just as caring, just as guiding, just as strengthening, just as forgiving as ever. Like Hebrews 13:8 says, Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. You want more joy? Don't just look ahead to when things will get back to normal, but look above to the Lord right now. That's really the only true and lasting source of joy anyway. What great topics these are for us to study about in Philippians, okay? To study about standing firm in the Lord, about agreeing in the Lord, about rejoicing in the Lord. These all fit so much in today's society of hardship and challenges and sadness and depression and relational schisms and so forth. He addresses all these things in such a pertinent way. Now, next week, we're going to talk a lot more about this. Paul goes even deeper and addresses peace and contentment, which really add on to the unity and the joy in the Lord like that. All this is such good stuff. But the more we understand and embrace this theme of Philippians, to live as Christ and to die as gain, the more we'll truly be able to stand firm in the Lord, agree in the Lord, and rejoice in the Lord always. Amen. Now, I've got some discussion questions, as always, for you to think about or maybe discuss in your families or your small groups. What stands out to you the most in this section? What are some ways you've seen conflicts resolved in the church, either in your own life or the lives of others? And what were some helpful steps along the way? 3, what can you do to find more joy in the Lord, especially during these challenging times we're facing? Okay, those are some good food for thought questions. Now we're going to go into communion, and then we'll have one final closing announcement. Would you pray with me? Father in heaven, thank you for caring about our joy, for caring about our relationships, for wanting us to stand firm. And thank you for this incredible message from Paul to help us to have all that. Thank you that we're allowed to be in the Lord. And so we have the opportunity, and we have the motivation and the strength to really be victorious in all those ways. Thank you for Jesus dying on the cross that makes it all possible. Thank you for His love. Thank you for His body that was lived perfectly and sacrificially for us. Thank you for His blood that He gave up for us. As we take this bread that symbolizes His body and the juice that symbolizes His blood, we focus on Him and fix our eyes on Jesus. It's in His name we pray. Amen. Okay, amen. And final announcement here. It's just a reminder of our special missions offering here in the Des Moines Church of Christ. Here in Des Moines, we get really excited about this. It's for Africa, for Hope Worldwide, and for Iowa missions. Now, you can start giving right now. Many people already have. You can give anytime up until October 18th. That's the last day that we can give. And give via our website, DesMoinesCoc.org. You can go there, click on the contribution link, and then there's a way to note that your offering is for missions contribution. So thank you so much for considering that. It's great to be with you again this week. I look forward to seeing you all next week as we wrap up chapter 4 in Philippians. God bless you.